Connect this session to get you aligned with the next session that we will start today, and believe me, you will have an excellent experience when you will be exposed to the software and what that software with which you will do it. To give a brief introduction of that, so let us little bit revisit of this radio network planning. Actually, in IIT we offer a course of telecommunication network planning and management dedicatedly for it's a one semester course. So, I have tried to give, apart from the management section, only the planning section, part of the planning I have tried to keep here to give you an overview how actually we do the deployment in the practice. So, you have gone through a lot of the theoretical classes regarding the other short range wireless communications and all. So, in this session you will try to see that if we go for deploying a short range communication network, so what's the experience is about. So, before deployment, let us see today what are the things that we should learn, we should know, and how the service providers deploy a network. Okay. See, this network planning is basically a pillar, a fundamental work for the deployment project, I should say. More rigid your planning is, as usual, more good will be your deployment process itself. How can you make your planning very rigid? How can you make your planning very nice and cost effective? Nice in the sense cost effective, quality effective, and also your capacity effective, coverage effective, effectively from various sense. That is a very tedious job, and a very not only tedious, it is a very detailed job, I should say, which involves lot of things. For example, nominal planning, something called detailed planning, and then involving optimization procedure. So, the last term that you are seeing here, it is not a theoretical work purely. It is a blend of the measurements, the field trials, top of that the knowledge of the optimization applied on the parameter setting, final parameter setting for the networks. If we start from the nominal planning itself, what is this about is, you first wish to understand, if you are a service provider, you wish to understand the very preliminary question. I have a given area to be covered. I understand the technology I should support, but I do not know how many number of the base stations or the APs will be sufficient to give the coverage in this area. So, planning first asks the question here. If you are giving an area, if you are given an area, if you understand the wireless technology I should support, if I know what is the data rate needs to be supported, and I know what is the SINR coverage also correspondingly needs to be supported. I also understand what is the modulation coding scheme I should give, because I know the technology name. I will go to the standard document, I will get all the document stuff parameters from the document, but I really do not know. No, none of the standards nor the researchers will tell you how many number of the APs now you need, or the base stations you need, or the InnoDBs you need to now to start the deployment. This is the fundamental question with which planning starts. When we do the nominal planning, basically we do an exercise on the finding out the very initial number of the required sites. Sites means it is a cluster of the coverage areas. So, how many number of the such coverage areas I should be able to deal with? I can simply relate it with the structure of the cellular network that is there in your mind. Open up the Rappaport's book once again. The way you understand the cellular communication is, there are certain cells, whether it is a hexagonal side of shape or it is a round shape. So, like that, imagine here we are having some circular sites. We need to understand how many such sites required to be covered. So, finding out the number of the sites is equivalent to the number of the base stations for the outdoor communication. Also, for the indoor, it is equivalent to the finding of number of the APs that we need to cover. As we are talking about the sites, remember the sites should be overlapping. There should not be any gap in between. That will be the blind zone otherwise. none of the APs will cover that area. Clear? So, that planning should be there. Nominal planning basically depends on a pen and paper calculation. Today we will see how do we do it. That is called radio link budget. Do you remember yesterday in the last talk I was showing you some table where I was showing that see look, this is a transmit power level for millimeter wave communication, this is a path loss going on, this is the antenna gains and this is the noise figure and the implementation losses and finally whether we are having some budget or not. We saw that without beamforming we are not having any kind of the budget left for the millimeter wave communication. So, antenna gain we put both at the transmitter as well as receiver, we got some budget. Now, we start believing that yes, now the communication is possible. So, fundamental rule is you have to calculate the budget with all the requirements given by your customer and then try to find out whether we are ending up with some positive values of signal to noise ratio or not. It is very, very mandatory to end up with a positive value of signal to interference noise ratio, without which there is no possibility that in practice that typical design will work. You will never be able to recover a single bit of the information in the receiver. Okay, that's definite. So, you have to have a positive budget. After having some nominal planning with the budget and finding out what will be the approximate number of the sites with which we should proceed, we enter into detailed planning. Detailed planning basically try to enter into the sites. Within each and every site, now you can ask me what is the meaning of sites. Sites actually can be the some urban areas, rural areas, close to the base station, very far from the base station, I mean the cell edges, like that we can define. There is no hard and fast rule the way you will define your sites for the deployment. But whenever we have defined sites by the nominal planning, in the detailed planning, we try to enter into the sites and we take care of some detailed parameters. What are the parameters we will now take into the action? The antenna direction, its down tilting, its power level. Based on all that, we try to now finally try to see the whether the site, the size, the coverage area of the sites, they are feasible or they are not. With the constraint of all these design parameters, whether the number of the in-node Bs and the sites that we have decided in the nominal planning needs to be modified, needs to be revisited, needs to be changed or not. Remember, alone with the pen and paper, we cannot go this detailed planning. Detailed planning really needs some kind of the field measurements. So, in this situation, service providers actually put the some transmitter and receiver according to the nominal planning and all whatever we got, that according to that plan we try to do some trial field measurements. Okay? Suppose in the budget we could find that see you can cover the 10 meter distance with a plus 7 dBm your budget and with DPSK modulation it is possible to receive the signal in the phi layer and with certain antenna gains. So, practically now deploy one transmitter and receiver, testing transmitter, testing receiver at a distance of the 10 meter, try to see the measurements over the variable general conditions and come back with that field trial results and revisit your radio network planning, revisit your budget once again. Okay? You will definitely see there is a hell and heaven difference when the measurements are taken and they are incorporated in the result. So, detailed planning is one step ahead. We try to do the, we actually whenever we are doing the measurements, we are taking care of the propagation models. So, the effect of the propagation models now will come into the design constraint to optimize, to finally fine tune your parameters in the detailed planning. Last comes the optimization. Optimization after doing the fine tuning on the sites and the parameters, then again we go for pre-launching and post-launching optimization. In the optimization, finally you are trying to do the last fine and the tuning, last fine tuning on your design parameters. For example, you started with certain number of the antenna gains, certain tilting and certain transmitted power. Remember, transmitted power is always restricted by FCC, the highest power that you can transmit with. Usually, we do not go at the initial point with the highest power transmission. We try to keep a budget limit, we try to start with the lowering that limit and try to optimize with the other stuff that are within our hand. If at the final stage of this optimization, which is we are close to the deployment, then that budget that is kept between the FCC maximum limit and the power limit with which we are trying to deploy, that gap helps us to actually adjust the problem of the parameter adjustments of the whole network. Suppose if you have come up with a tilt direction or some antenna number of antennas and its power level, almost all the equipments are purchased, and then it is very hard to change a major part of the network, then where we will go, we will little bit increase the power, transmit power of the level to adjust the losses that are happening because of this parameter tuning, and do not cross the highest limit of the FCC that is given by the FCC. So, we are allowed. Okay? This optimization is having two effects. Number one, it is intuitive, is not it? More the network will run, more I will get the online testing parameters, the output of the network, more I can tune my design. Okay? Sitting on the in the lab, doing the design on pen and paper, checking it on a software planning tool is one job, and deploying it in the network, let it run over the years and then see the way the network is behaving, then you will see at least you have a error of 30% to 40% from your design in the pen and paper to the software to the actual deployment. So, the 30% to 40% is the post launch or the post deployed optimization for which there should be a complete backup or the complete gap where you will touch the network parameter optimization from the field results that you are getting over the months or over the years. So, even after deployment of the network, network is on trial say for 1 month. We keep the network on trial for 1 month. Usually when certain service provider provides a network, they provide the access to very limited number of the users you will see, or they say actually a certain city with a very restricted area, because you will see that is the testing phase of that network. Okay? Recently, Vodafone 4G was released, right? It was launched only in a very few metro cities like Calcutta, that also in a limited area, Bombay, that also in the limited area. Why? The provider tried to see whatever the calculation they did and whatever the network they are deploying, it should work. What is the quality of service that network is giving? Based on that, they will do their parameter optimization, post launch parameter optimization. Question is, where do we take help of this software in the process of this planning? Usually it is after the budget calculation pen and paper is done in the nominal one, we enter into the detail planning. So, inside the detail planning, we really try to see, suppose we according to this budget calculation, this many number of the APs I will place, I will really place it in the software and we will try to see what is the throughput coming up, what is the signal to interference noise ratio profile coming up to me, what is the total data rate coming up, whether if my calculation is saying that I should get a bit error rate of 10 to the power minus 5 with a 7 kbps data rate for a distance of say 1 kilometer after deploying all of the users, all the APs, whether really I am getting it, I will add some of the field parameters. Parameters now in which is what? I will really deploy it on a building plan. In calculation, I am not taking care of the absorptions, scattering effects, wireless channel problems in the budget. This is not possible. We do it over the AWGN kind of environment. Now, software will help you to actually put it on a building plan, where the real walls will be there, or the real scatterers will be there, absorbers will be there, reflectors will be there, other scatterers also will be there. And depending upon the radio frequency you are using, each and every material will behave in a different way. Their reflection coefficients, their scattering coefficients, their diffraction coefficients, each will keep on changing. So, you will be able to really nicely see that what is actually the profile of the signal to interference noise ratio coming up. and you will be able to realize how I am differing from the pen and paper calculation to the first level of deployment through a software. This is a detail. Next, you wish to revisit your budget. Okay. So, this task we will do today in the lab. Further, so what's the motivation, what's the final target of this planning should be? See, we explain it by a means of a pyramid. Everything related to the deployment of a network, the center point is the cost function. Cost function for a network, we define by two parameters. One is the capex, another is opex. Capex stands for capital expenditure. That is basically the expenditure that is happening when network is actually getting deployed, cost of the deployment of the network. OPEX is related to the operational expenditure. When the network is running continuously, you have a backup for the power. The power loss that is happening because of the retransmission, huge kind of the blockage that is happening because of your mal planning of the dimensioning of the network. That is why actually the cost is going up, or how the cost is going up, that is the operating cost itself. Here actually the meaning of the cost is at the time of deployment, mainly the capex I am talking about. This capex will be always dependent on the coverage in one sense, capacity in another direction, quality of service that the network should offer in another direction, and the time that you are taking to deploy the network. Clear? What is this coverage? If I do not know what is the minimal size of my sites, how many number of the sites I am going to do, I cannot get the number of the InnodeBs or number of the APs. So, directly it is related to the number of the APs. More the number of the APs, cost is more. More the coverage, cost is more. Direct relation. Capacity, if you are going for a very high capacity network, gigabit per second transmission will go on. Per bit transmission cost is a very important factor for your deployment. Okay. You increase the capacity, definitely cost will be increased. Okay. Third is quality of service. We were talking about it, right? Why we switch from 3G to 4G to 5G now? Every time actually, whenever you provide a service, it is related to the quality that the service you are giving him. It may be a network, it may be a some social service, it may be a education system, it may be a medical system, quality is always related. So, telecommunication network also, whenever you are providing the data rate that you have promised, how much, how percentage, what is the percentage of that promised data rate actually the user is experiencing is a very big factor. Second thing is the delay. I am ready to get with a little bit lower data rate, I would not mind. But you cannot actually allow me to wait for a day to get actually some data through the network. So, the quality constraint here is based on the latency of the network, the delay of the network, as well as the promised data rate that you have done for this kind of the service. How much percentage of that data rate I am really getting? Okay. There are a lot of the factors in the network design which controls the quality of service. In physical layer, quality of service means what? How do we measure the quality of service in the physical layer? Simple, bit error rate. Okay. The thing that we understand. In the MAC layer design, we try to control it by the packet error rate. Go higher, frame error rate and all will keep on coming. We will do the link budget calculation based on the packet error rate, you will see. Deployment time, everything is perfect, very nice quality of service balance, very nice coverage calculation, capacity calculation, we need to optimize my cost, to minimize my cost. But the moment the plan was frozen and the moment I went for deploying it, the time gap is so high. So, whatever the cost was there, the market price for each and every component of the network, it has grown up. So, your plan will fail. So, deployment time itself is a very big issue in the whole planning project. So, this is detail of all the nominal detail and the optimization process of the radio network. If we go in detail of this coverage, quality of service and capacity estimate, basically we will start with the quality of service first. Quality of the service mainly can be divided into two halves: high quality network and low quality network. We understand. High quality network means your data throughput of the network is really very high. Customer satisfaction is also very high. And low quality network means your definitely the satisfaction is level is low, and quality of the service, I mean the amount of data rate you are getting, that is also low. Remember, when you are trying to design a very high quality service network, definitely your planning is such that the efficiency of each and every component of the network that you are choosing for the designing of the network, they are of highly efficient. So, once the efficiency is really very high, the cost of each and every component, where are you paying? The cost of each and every component is going to high. Question number 2, if you are planning to do the highest data rate, everybody is served with the highest data rate possible by the network, then when the peak data rate requirement is not there, most of the time it is not the spectrally efficient network that you are, the way you are handling the spectrum given to you is not efficient. If you try to design with the peak data rate always, then you will be in high trouble when all those users are not present in your network. That is not the proper usage of the spectrum going on. Okay. Problem is what, you know, there is a very nice measurement criteria and parameter also to check how this measurement of the quality will be done. Measurement of the quality is done in terms of average revenue per user, we call it ARPU. You see the figure, we have kept it on the y axis. So, per user, what is the average revenue we are getting from the users when the network is already deployed? See, if the quality is low, I understand, you will get a lower ARPU. So, the average people are bugged with your network. So, they are not ready to pay high for your network. Per call basis, the cost that you can claim from the users, if your quality is extremely poor, nobody will be ready to pay you. So, ARPU will be definitely low. Can you tell me why for the very high quality of the network also, the ARPU will be very low? CapEx is so high, you have deployed, you can never recover that amount, that cost from the market. Okay? Because even if there is no balance between the number of the users you can support at a particular time, that means the network density, and the cost that you are deploying for the at the time of the deployment, that is the CapEx, if there is a very big difference between these two, you can never recover your CapEx. Okay. So, RPU is heavily possible that the RPU will be heavily down. Best possibility for all kind of the network, maybe indoor or the outdoor, proceed with the medium quality of the network. So, promise the medium quality of the service to the users always, and design and optimize the network based on the optimum quality, where the data rate cannot be peak data rate, but some average data rate which is pretty good and high for different kind of the applications. Also, the latency not ultra fast, but at least with some good latency you can go ahead with. Coverage and the capacity planning also is done accordingly. So, overall the quality of the service will be in the medium. Remember, for assuring the quality of the service, there is a term in the network which is called dimensioning of the network. How do we do the dimensioning of the network is, it is heavily dependent on whether what is the load of the network, the peak load of the network, and the average data rate that you are promising to serve. When the peak load is there, okay, peak load is there, what is the chance? What is the next immediate effect coming up? When the network is experiencing the peak load, sometime happens, right? Suppose at 10 to 12, during 10 to 12, the all the networks you look, the network will have a very peak load. Maximum users are trying to communicate. Then what will you do? fast effect, you may get some delay. If it doesn't work, then what will happen? Completely the blockage. It's a drop because you are experiencing the blockage. So whenever you are dimensioning the network, you have to also keep in the mind that I should start with the blockage probability. Okay. And what is the minimum delay my network can tolerate? If I am trying to do the blockage probability calculation properly, then don't be very rigid with the blockage also. Keep some flexibility, thinking that this network is flexible, this network will be extended in future. If I am extending the future, in future I am extending the capacity of the network in terms of widening the channel bandwidth, in terms of actually adding some extra spectrum with that, chance of that is there. And also the flexibility in the increasing in the capacity of the coverage and the capacity both direction. So then the blockage may not be actually properly done with which I started my initial calculation. Maybe when your channel bandwidth is only 40 megahertz, the blockage will be high compared to when you are having 160 megahertz. Clear? So if my network density is not increasing that way, so you have to predict over the down the line of the 5 years, what is the expected increase on my network density, the users, and hence how the blockage probability profile will be looking like from now to then. And then what is the condition, what, how the technology is evolving, what is the chance that I will shift from this lower frequency zone to the higher frequency zone, and I have a chance to get the higher signal bandwidth, some channel bandwidth, hence my signal bandwidth will be increasing and all. So all that type, and whether I will get the chance of very nice technology to support like the channel aggregation or not. Okay. So whenever I am increasing my bandwidth, definitely the capacity is also increasing. So the way capacity is increasing, how density of the network is expected to increase, how, what is the relation between the blockage versus density increase versus the capacity increase. These are very highly calculating stuff, optimization framework networks, and then you have to also calculate something that is dimensioning, redimensioning, and dynamic dimensioning, I should say. Then whenever we talk about redimensioning, it's not like that you sit with a network for 2 years. You keep on adding all the complaints, and then after 2 years you start thinking that I will do now do something for addressing the problems. No, it's a dynamic dimensioning. Over every 7 days or every 15 days you try to start addressing by means of parameter optimization, continuous parameter optimization of the networks. So that much flexibility you have to come up with. Okay. Yeah. True. So that's why the people who will deploy the network in Puri, where actually it is expected that this thing will happen, the design of the network in Puri, Ratha Yatra or Kumbh Mela there, and designing the network in a Kharagpur state city, here hell and heaven difference having. So over the year, it is a history of that area, the history of the events that is expected to happen in that area and the effect of it on the telecommunication network, that's the prediction algorithm that you have to keep on always doing. So you see in the detailed program, detailed planning, that's why we wrote our point that we have to have something prediction algorithm always running inside it. So detection is detailed planning we do based on this kind of the prediction also. But wherever the prediction fails, we always try to keep some resources of the network blocked or reserved to address these issues. At least we will get a time span of 1 year. We should get a span of 1 year to think again how to expand in a bigger level next. Okay. So that span. Pardon? Mobile BTS, if you are putting suddenly, no, actually you have to put the infrastructure also for that. So that's the flexibility addition. How much flexible your network is to expand. So flexibility is a very fundamental term always coming up. So for this kind of the applications or the way the solution you are thinking of, for that actually ad hoc network forming and suddenly means adding this ad hoc network with the infrastructure always already prevailing networks and all. So how much your network already deployed network is flexible to adopt that, that depends on whether you can extend in this fashion or not. And that is only possible if that whole dimensioning process is done with the considering all this flexibility to be incorporated in the network from the beginning itself. So I am saying actually you keep the reserve resources in the network planning. So if it is the quality of the service, then next is the capacity planning. Capacity planning is again dependent upon what exactly you started with the service, what was the bit per second per user you promised, what was the quality of the service you promised, and then the capacity, available capacity heavily depends on the time and location. Time is when the Rath Yatra will come, capacity may will go down. Location wise means suppose I have a terrain condition, heavily hilly area where I am deploying, and I have a plain land where I am deploying. Okay. So, location based capacity is possible. Capacity will heavily vary because the valley situation, valley channel condition itself is not same for these two area. You cannot promise uniform capacity for both of these area for a same kind of the network and same kind of the resources allotted to both of them. Modulation coding that you are adopting capacity and coverage of the network, we can also do via the planning tool. Coverage planning, definitely it demands for which location you are starting with. Is it the Kashmir border or it is the Assam border or it is the plain land, it is the seaside, what exactly it is where you are starting with. So there is an example now. So please listen this example very minutely. A very similar calculation is given to your sessional. Okay. It will help you to understand what is written on the sessional, and tomorrow similar problem you have to solve, and solve this problem by today night and come tomorrow morning in the lab. So how to calculate the link budget is the discussion about. We will take a case study with the ultra wideband. We have understood this technology. It is having a 3.1 to 10.6 7.5 gigahertz wide band. It can support a variable data rate of 100 to 500 Mbps. I understand that minimum operating bandwidth here is 500 megahertz. So channel bandwidth will be 500 megahertz, and the distance I will cover now is only 10 meter. Let us try to see whether we can design it or not. Also, we understand that the transmission power will be having a power spectral density of minus 41.5 dBm per megahertz kind of. And budget should always be aware of what is the spectral mask given by FCC. So this is a typical stuff that a customer came to you and told that, hello, I need a UWB system redesigned. You consider that it will be covering 10 meter distance. It should have at least one 500 megahertz wide band. So the central frequency is 3.35 gigahertz, because 3.1 to 500 means 3.1 to 3.6, it will be central frequency will be around 3.35 or 3.3. So the central frequency of the transmission, the value of FC is equal to 3.35. Then transmit power, it is given by FCC. You have nothing to do. You open up the standard document, you will be able to see. So maximum transmit power for this band is minus 10.3 dBm. Transmit receiver antenna gain, we will always start with 0, because remember putting the gain of the antenna, it is completely your design, it is in your hand. At any point of time, you can make our antenna from omnidirectional to the sectorized to increase the gain. You can put the multiple antennas on the top of it. So, but always start with the 0 dB. If you can show some budget with 0 dB, then if I am adding some gain on the antenna, definitely I will have higher budget in my hand. I can play with it nicely in the planning. So, never start with the sectorized antenna, highly beamformed antenna, because it will not, you will not be able to see the strength of the design without all those extra functionality or feasibility added in the design. Distance covered should be 10 meter, and it is given that the minimum required dB by N naught is 4 dB around. This is with the BPSK we will try to see. Receiver noise figure is 7 dB. Implementation loss, these losses are all the losses whenever you are trying to deploy the system, transmitter receiver system, the RF sections, other devices who are will be there on the line, the losses in the electronic components that are expected to be there, you have to keep a budget for them. For example, you are putting an antenna and there is a feeder cable from the RF section to the antenna, that cable will have some loss. Okay. That loss will be in the base station for outdoor communication, there is no loss in your handset. So, whenever we will have your downlink calculation, you will have the loss. For uplink calculation, you will have the loss on the receiver side, not in the transmitter side. So, remember all that when you will keep on going. We are starting with this data rate. Customer also said me that I have a requirement of 100 Mbps data rate. They said I need to cover a distance of 10 meter. The way a customer comes like this, hello, they won't say that I need a UWB system. They will say, hello, I have need to have a design of a transmitter receiver that should cover a zone of 10 meter. I need a speed of data rate of 100 Mbps, and in the failure, say in the MAC, the packet error rate minimum required is 8%. Now you do. Okay. Now it is your task as a radio planner and a radio engineer to start with the searching of a technology that will be best fit for giving you 100 Mbps data rate. As the distance is short, 10 meter, you are in a safe side. You can search for all the short range communication standards and technologies that you are aware of. So, if it is something like that and there is restriction, you should ask the customer, do you have any restriction on the transmitted power? Because power is always related to the cost of the device that you will design. If they say yes, I am having a restriction on the power, then the design will proceed towards one direction. If there is no restriction on the power transmission, then the design will go in the other direction. I can choose any hi-fi technology where the power high power transmission is always allowed, always agreed. High power transmission means you can cover higher distance also, that is another plus point. Okay. Either you should have a very high power for covering higher distance, or you should have a low data rate requirement when the power restriction is there to cover the high distance. Good part is here they are asking only for the 10 meter distance. We chose UWB to start with, hence your average transmit power is given by FCC minus 10.3. As per the design rule, we started with the antenna gains for the both transmitter and receiver as 0 dBi. So, center frequency is 3.35. We can calculate the path loss combinedly L1 plus L2. We understand it is 4 pi d fc by c. Okay. So, this d is the distance of 10 meter. Fc here is my 3.35 gigahertz. C is the speed of the light. You keep on calculating, you will get the path loss directly as a distance of the d meter. If I start the transmission with minus 10.3 meter, what is the power of the will be there at the distance of 10 meter, the front end of receiver. That is the first calculation we have done. So, received power, which is Pt plus Gt plus Gr minus the losses, will be ending up with minus 73.24 dBm for this design. Next calculation is you calculate the noise power. This is a AWGN, okay, additive wide Gaussian noise power, and there is a typical calculation for this. We follow this formula: per bit the noise power will be minus 174 plus 10 log 10 of this data rate that you are targeting. If the data rate is known to you, it is easily calculated, you can calculate it easily. Noise figure, usually we keep 5 to 7 dB for any kind of the system design. We have kept it in the higher side, because if you can show the budget with a higher budget for the noise power, In the practice, it is definite it will work. Total noise power definitely is the per bit noise power you have calculated and the noise figure that you are considering. So, additively n plus nf is minus 87, my receiver power was here minus 73.24 dBm. We have also taken care of the minimum required dB by n naught for this 8% frame error rate is 4 dB. And implementation loss is kept 3 dB. This is the link margin, the way the formula with which you can calculate. Put all the values and check whether you have some positive budget in the calculation or not. The 7 dB extra budget, extra 7 dB power I can have if I go by this design is the meaning. Okay? And corresponding the receiver sensitivity is minus 80.24 dBm. Question number 1, I know I have an extra 7 dB budget. Good part is, if my design is very nice, I have designed the whole transmitter receiver and practically after deploying I am seeing it is working very nicely lengthwise, transmitter to receiver connection is going nice. Still I am having a 7 dB extra budget, what I will do with this? Customer will come and ask you. Hello, why are you doing with this extra 7 dB? This extra power you have kept in your hand suddenly, what will you do with that? Increase the data rate, very nice. You can tell sales to, hey, hello, tomorrow if you wish to increase the data rate of your network, this is the extra budget. Today I am showing your BPSK transmission you are doing. Tomorrow you come and tell me to double the data rate. So, I will increase, I have this budget. So, you need not to do any change in that system. You can do it nicely. Okay. Higher modulation you can opt definitely to increase the data rate. Next. Quality of the service is ensured actually if you are taking this V by N naught. How you will increase the quality of service? Hold on please. No, how this 7 dB will be utilized for the enhancement of the quality? No. If there is any additional loss, I can utilize it. Remember, I have not added the filter, front end amplifier filter, they are there. Front end amplifier will give you another 5 to 6 dB gain. So, that is another additive part that you have not declared to your customer. Straightforward link budget you have shown, but my question is, this can be done. What he is suggesting, with this 7 dB, I can improve the quality of the service. Anybody or MTech students are sitting. So, any suggestion, Pradeep, any suggestion that we can increase that quality of the service by this 7 dB? You deploy diversity. Okay. Whenever we are deploying diversity by terms of increasing the number of antenna, increasing the antenna from CISO to MIMO, the extra power you need, you are copying the same data over the next antenna path to increase the diversity. So, if the diversity order is increasing by 2, so at least 3 dB increment, 3 dB extra power requirement you need to increase the diversity twofold. So, quality of the service I can do, okay, by either actually adding extra antenna or by repeating it in some other frequency, in some other code, lot of the techniques are there. Straightforward to understand, I can make the MIMO, but the MIMO is not utilized for multiplexing. It is utilizing for diversity, but the power requirement is there for transmission on the second path. So, that power where from it will come, this budget that you have kept, I will utilize some part of the power from here for my diversity. True, then transmit power can be reduced. If required, she is suggesting that you can further reduce the transmit power if required. We do not prefer, okay. But think from the receiver side itself, what else I can do? distance cover I will increase. Very nice suggestion. Another thing, so distance cover I can increase, data rate I can increase, diversity, quality of service improvement is possible. Fourth one, what about the multi-user? When multiple users will be on in the network, your interference will be keeping on increasing. Okay? So, for that yours, now it is not the SNR, it is the SINR you have to calculate. So, for the increase of the interference amount, where from will you do the budgeting? The budgeting that the signal power needs to be increased now somehow, or the improvement in the bit error rate to keep the bit error rate same. Actually, in the presence of interference, I need some extra signal power to put for the transmission. So, if I wish to put that, this budget from extra budget, that settlement will be done. So, in a multi-user environment, if you keep on increasing the number of the users and test the bit error rate continuously, one user transmitting, two users transmitting, three users keep on increasing, you will see after a certain number of the users, this design is failing. It is unable to give you at all 10 to the power minus 5 bit error rate with some increment of the whatever the budget you are having, with all exhausted, extra signal power exhausted even, you are, there is a limit. Beyond that, if you keep on increasing the number of users, it will never come down. BER will never come down to 10 to the power minus 5 limit. So, that is a calculation of how many number of the users, maximum number of the users you can now accommodate. Okay. So, keeping budget is always preferable, it is required, it brings the flexibility in your design. You keep it reserved, if somebody asks you why are you keeping it, these are the answers that for which to add the flexibility, to add the extension or expansion of the network for the future, keeping in mind that multi-user scenario can be handled, I need to keep extra budget. So, always it is profitable to keep budget extra. Like this, now may I request you all to open up your sessional document. Just refer the budget.